2, Professor Gwyn Williams steps deeper into the legend of King Arthur.
Excalibur! The real Arthur emerged in Britain after the collapse of the Roman Empire. After his death, he becomes first a Welsh myth, then a Norman one. In the Middle Ages, he conquers Europe. For 300 years, he towers over that continent like a cathedral of the intellect and the spirit.
But was there something pagan lurking in that cathedral? That paganism just below the surface was part of the very appeal of the Arthurian legends. The crusading monks of the militant Cistercian order were determined to exorcise it.
The holy quest shifted towards the severely spiritual, and it was the Cistercians, with their mysticism, backed by their military wing, the Knights Templars, who were the moving spirit behind the Vulgate cycle, the most comprehensive and popular Arthurian text to emerge from the Middle Ages. The Vulgate version of the Arthur story builds on pagan Celtic sources. Earlier writers had taken their magic drinking vessels and tried to exorcise them into a holy grail. The grail becomes central. The Cistercians tried to cut it free from all paganism.
Suddenly, the hall was lit by a sunbeam, which shed a radiance through the palace 7 times brighter than had been before. The Holy Grail appeared, and yet no mortal hand was seen to bear it. It had entered through the great door, and at once the palace was filled with fragrance, as though all the spices of the earth had been spilled abroad.
It is fired by religion in its most austere and demanding form, with its commitment to the full values of transubstantiation and to virginity as an absolute. This Cistercian version of the Arthurian stories brilliantly achieves the integration of the doomed love of Lancelot and Guinevere into the tragedy of Arthur and weaves it into the epic of the Grail and the Round Table. Lancelot's adultery puts Arthur in a cruel dilemma.
He knew perfectly well that if Lancelot were caught in adultery and put to death, there would be such a great torment in the country as had never before been caused by the death of a single knight. And yet it was better that Lancelot should die than that a king's dishonor should not be avenged before his death.
The major achievement, without doubt, is the dual character of Lancelot. He is treated with sympathy, but his adultery is clearly seen as a betrayal of the king and of the divine order. As the king goes off on a hunting expedition, Lancelot moves into the trap that has been set by knights hostile to him.
Lancelot, who did not suspect that he was being watched, passed from room to room until he came to where the queen was expecting him. When Lancelot was inside, he locked the door after him.
Unlike the raunchy versions of the Lancelot and Guinevere story by previous writers, the Cistercians soon brought the adultery to a stop. To them, unchastity was the root of all evil.
Lancelot, raising his sword, struck him so violently with all his force that neither his helmet nor his iron coif could save him from being split to the shoulders. When the others saw what had happened to him, they all drew back and left the doorway quite empty.
Lancelot flees the court. This is the beginning of the end of the Round Table.
They failed to find Lancelot, and rejoiced in their hearts at their failure, well knowing what they had been spared. In his disappointment, Arthur desired to have his revenge on the Queen at once. A great and powerful fire was lit, in which the Queen would be burnt, because a Queen who was guilty of treachery could die in no other way. When the king saw her, he felt such great pity for her that he was unable to look at her, but commanded her to be taken from him.
Lancelot rescues Guinevere in the nick of time, but war breaks out between Arthur and Lancelot. This enables Mordred, in this a version Arthur's own son by incest, to usurp the throne, and Arthur advances for the last battle on Salisbury Plain.
Arthur and his knights, with some help from Lancelot, are victorious. Mordred is killed, but Arthur is mortally wounded. Alone with his faithful Giroflée, Arthur orders him to throw Excalibur into the lake. Twice he fails to do so. Then follows the first appearance of that marvelous scene in literature, 800 years after the real Arthur.
He hurled it into the lake as deep and as far from him as he could. And as it fell near the water, he saw a hand come out of the lake, which revealed itself up to the elbow. But he saw nothing of the body to which it belonged. The hand seized the sword by the hilt and brandished it in the air 3 times.
The French Vulgate makes a fitting climax to the whole Arthurian cycle. But it also marks the beginning of its decay. The church, though it supplied some of the authors, had always been wary of it. The romances of the Holy Grail seemed highly suspect, rank with visionary ideas which were at root a pagan heresy. In 1312, the Knights Templars, who'd been the cutting edge of the Crusades, were suppressed by papal decree.
The whole Arthurian cycle had become irrelevant by the time of the great discoveries, with their wrenching of Europe's center of gravity to the Atlantic seaboard, with the religious cleavage between Catholics and Protestants, who regarded the romances with horror, with the influx of Greek thought, rationalism, the humanism of Erasmus. The Renaissance was to look upon Arthurian romance with indifference or even detestation.
To some, then as now, the Arthurian myths had become a bit of a joke.
cut.
Cervantes in Spain, whose Don Quixote had satirized the whole thing, wrote its sharpest epitaph.
Their style is hard. Their adventures are incredible. Their love affairs lewd. Their travels preposterous. And lastly, they are devoid of all art and sense.
I'm stuck.
And therefore deserve to be banished from a Christian commonwealth as a useless tribe.
Pull her up.
There was one great exception to this 15th century decline. Britain. Glastonbury Abbey. The monks here seized on the French idea that Joseph of Arimathea had brought the chalice from the Last Supper to Glastonbury. They claimed that this was the Holy Grail and that here too was Joseph's tomb. That's where they said the body of Joseph of Arimathea lay. Discovering distinguished bodies, an ancient clerical habit, seems to have been a tradition at Glastonbury. They claim to have disinterred St. Patrick, St. Gildas, not to mention the Archbishop Dunstan of Canterbury. Back in 1191, the monks announced the most sensational exhumation of them all. Arthur and Guinevere, reburied over there. Most historians now dismiss the whole thing as a typical monastic fake.
The Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now at the hour of death.
Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
The monk's fakery in the early Middle Ages wasn't done just to boost the pilgrim trade, still thriving at Glastonbury. The French-speaking monarchy was keen to take over the Arthur story from its Celtic origins. What stuck in their throats was the notion that he might return, cherished by the Welsh, Cornish, and Bretons.
In excelsis Deo.
Not until that idea was well and truly buried and Wales itself conquered, could the monarchy wholeheartedly embrace the legends in that characteristic blurring of Britain with England, which has been the bane of lesser breeds who occupied the fringes of the island ever since. This seemed to round everything off perfectly. At last it got rid of the pesky Welsh, Cornish, Breton notion that Arthur would return. So Arthur had returned to Britain at last, but not to his Celtic roots. The English monarchy had taken him over and buried him. No revival in Avalon for their Arthur. The dream of Rhonabwy, the last effective Arthurian story in Welsh, seems to offer a sour comment on it all.
Mor dris y teimlaf, fod dynion mor wael a'r hain yn cynnal yr ynys hon. Ar ôl y dynion glew a'i chynhaliau gynt.
There will be a resurrection, but in the 13th century, the Arthurian world is dead for the Welsh. We was robbed. Arthur is now moved firmly back into England. The early Middle Ages located his Camelot quite wrongly at Tintagel. Richard, Duke of Cornwall, seems to have rebuilt Tintagel Castle in the 13th century simply because it figured so prominently in the tales. His brother, King Henry III, may have ordered the Round Table here at Winchester in its original form in order to strengthen tenuous royal connections.
Certainly by the 15th century, most people thought that Winchester was Camelot, the site of Arthur's fort. Not true, of course. It was raised in the 11th century by William the Conqueror. But Sir Thomas Malory of Newbold Revel seems to have believed in the authenticity of both Camelot and the Round Table. He wrote his Maud Arthur at a time of civil war, the Wars of the Roses, in the 15th century, when the concern of most people was to find a good lord, financial security, and to see the land well governed.
Then stood the realm in great jeopardy long while, for every lord that was mighty of men made him strong, and many weened to have been king. Then Arthur said to himself, I will ride to the churchyard and take the sword that sticketh in the stone, for my brother Sir Kay shall not be without a sword this day. When he came to the churchyard, Sir Arthur alit and tied his horse to the stile. He found no knight there, for they were at jousting. And so he handled the sword by the handles, and lightly and fiercely pulled it out of the stone.
The tension between Christian and pre-Christian belief is at the heart of the Arthurian legends, a tension personified by Merlin.
And as they rode, Arthur said,
I have no sword, no force,
said Merlin.
Here is a sword that shall be yours.
In Malory, it is Merlin who leads Arthur to a second magical sword, Excalibur itself.
So they rode till they came to a lake, the which was of fair water and broad. And in the midst of the lake, Arthur was ware of an arm clothed in white samite that held a fair sword in that hand.
Lo,
said Merlin,
yonder is the sword that I speak of.
So Sir Arthur and Merlin alit, and they went into the ship. When they came to the sword that the hand held, Sir Arthur took it up by the handles and took it with him, and the arm and the hand went under the water.
Malory's work stands out like a great mountain from the English tradition of Arthurian writing, which is late and mediocre. He takes the Lancelot and Guinevere story from the French romances and gives it a distinctively English treatment. This very practical Lancelot brings a ladder with him.
And they made, either to the other, their complaints of many diverse things. Then Sir Lancelot wished that he might have come into her.
In the early French version, Lancelot, after breaking into Guinevere's chamber, kneels to adore the object of his love. In Malory's English version, it's wham, bam, thank you, ma'am.
To pass upon this tale, Sir Lancelot went into bed with the queen, and he took no forces of his queen, and he took no forces of his hurt hand, but took his pleasance and his liking until it was the dawning of the day.
Malory spent most of his life in prison, yet he gave new life to a dying tradition, at least in the English-speaking world. Thanks to Caxton, who reshaped him, and the printing press which published him in 1485, Malory made sure it never became a mere antiquarianism. He went on to win more hearts and minds.
Yet some men say in parts of England that King Arthur is not dead, that he shall come again. That many men say that it was written upon this tomb this verse: here lies Arthur, the once and future king.
Mallory did well to be cautious, for literally within days of Caxton's printing of his Mort Arthur, King Arthur himself landed at Dale in Milford Haven in the person of Henry Tudor. The Welsh had suffered peculiarly harsh colonization by England and the suppression of Owain Glyndŵr, their rebel leader, so they were pinning their hopes on a savior, preferably of Welsh descent from the ranks of the nobility. Henry Tudor became that savior, landing in Wales, collecting an army there, and flying the Red Dragon at the Battle of Bosworth Field in 1485. For many Welshmen, Bosworth was fought against the old enemy. Victory, they thought, meant that they had got Arthur back again.
The Welsh may now be said to have recovered their independence. For the most wise and fortunate Henry VII is a Welshman.
Well, not really, but he went through the motions. Henry called his son Arthur, though he died young, recognized St. David's Day, and packed his court with minor Welsh officials. His surviving son, Henry VIII, may have painted himself into the Round Table. Many Welshmen followed their king to London. The Tudors ushered in the most Welsh of all English centuries, when Wales enjoyed unusual prestige. The Welsh became junior partners in the English realm, but senior suppliers of its mythology. The necessary Tudor hunt for a legitimizing genealogy brought Arthur to the fore, and the Arthurian cycle reached its climax in learning, poetry, public ritual, propaganda, and found a voice in Spenser's hymn to British Empire and Elizabeth, the Fairy Queen.
That same knight's own sword, that is of yore, which Merlin made by his almighty art, for that his nursling, when he knighthood swore, therewith to doon his foes eternal smart. The land, which warlike Britons now possess, and therein have their mighty empire raised, in antique times was savage wilderness, unpeopled, unmanured, unproved, unpraised.
Poetry to justify savage repression in Ireland, which Spenser directly participated in.
How worthily, by heaven's high decree, justice that day of wrong herself had woken, that all men which that spectacle did see, by like example mote forever warned be. So, on a tree before the tyrant's door, he caused them to be hung in all men's sight, to be a monument forevermore.
Another more genial portrait of Elizabeth's empire came from John Dee, philosopher, mathematician, and magician. A fervent Welsh patriot and a passionate Arthurian, he was close to the Queen, and he seems to have coined the very expression, British Empire. He called on her to create a petty navy royal of 60 tall ships, and to recreate Arthur's great maritime empire in the north. Dee wrote four great works expounding the British Empire and its descent from Arthur. Among his many sources was William Lambard's Arthurian History of 1568.
His kingdom was too little for him, and his mind was not contented with it. So he subdued all Scantia, now called Norway, and all the islands beyond Norway, to wit, Iceland and Greenland, which are appertaining to Norway, the Arctic, Lapland, Winland, and the North Pole.
So Arthur Hunt for the Elizabethans become a sailor. Revived Arthur, building on earlier myths and sweeping on to the pole, Greenland, maybe even America, moved to a climax as hero of Britain.
Yet his glory was short-lived. Dee's enterprise was an anticlimax, as Elizabeth's advisers were lukewarm. In the end, he was banished to an English Siberia in Manchester, died in poverty. Back home with the coming of the Stuarts, Wales slithered into the backward province of poor Taffy, and the story of Arthur suffered an abrupt eclipse.
Arthurian literature in England followed that of Europe into oblivion. Mockery became the standard response as the legends declined into the world of folklore and chapels. Yet nearly 200 years later, an incredible and unexpected revival in England, which made Arthur the hero of a new Britain and installed him at the heart of British governance.
In the summer of 1809, the poet and painter William Blake was seized with an ambition to paint for the nation and hang in public places here in London giant portable frescoes of his own devising whose colors would be pure and permanent even if the subjects were 100 feet high. One of those a subject was to be King Arthur, and in the words of his catalogue,
"In the last battle of King Arthur, only 3 Britons escaped. These 3 marched through the field unsubdued as gods."
Blake revived the Celtic vision of Arthur and merged him with his vision of Albion to symbolize a regenerated Britain.
Blake's unique vision could have no real sequel. It was a product of his own inimitable genius and the interplay between native and long-established British radicalism and the French Revolution.
Great Britain was born in the 18th century. Through that century, punctuated by wars for trade and empire, and reaching a climax in the generation-long war against the French Revolution, a new British nation claimed its time had come, over the protests of radicals. This new Britain ran into the social tension of the early 19th century, but by the 1850s, it was counting down to the pudding time of mid-Victorian prosperity.
Throughout the period, the new Romanticism in its many phases bred an intensifying interest in the past, particularly the remote past. An unexpected consequence was the enthronement of King Arthur as first national hero of this new British. Then in 1834, a great fire attacked the Houses of Parliament, destroyed the Commons Chamber, badly damaged the Lords. This was their chance to build anew, just as the Reform Act of 1832 liberated and concentrated the energies of a new middle class.
The walls of the new palace seemed ideal to present to the public a national art which would tell the story of the nation at the very heart of government.
It was the Prince Regent, Prince Albert himself, who made the key choices. Here in the royal robing room of the House of Lords, the story of King Arthur. Albert invented the British Christmas, and he invented the new British Arthur.
By the time the paintings of William Dyce and the carvings of H.S. Armstrong, derived from Malory, were completed, Tennyson was poet laureate, and his Idylls of the King were being read by millions to tumultuous acclaim.
I was the first of all the kings who drew the knighthood errant of this realm and all the realms together under me their head. In that fair order of my table round, a glorious company, the flower of men, to serve as model for the mighty world and be the fair beginning of a time.
Tennyson was a devout monarchist.
I made them lay their hands in mine and swear to reverence the king as if he were their conscience and their conscience as their king. To break the heathen and uphold the Christ. To ride abroad redressing human wrongs. To speak no slander, know nor listen to it. To honor his own word as if his God's. To lead sweet lives in purest chastity. To love one maiden only, cleave to her, and worship her by years of noble deeds until they won her.
Arthur had become a Victorian gentleman.
Lancelot and Guinevere appear in Tennyson, but so discreetly. No hanky-panky, not even on their last night together.
And then they were agreed upon a night when the good king should not be there to meet and part forever. Passion pale they met and greeted. Hands in hands and eye to eye. Low on the border of her couch they sat, stammering and staring. It was their last hour and madness of farewell.
Tennyson's veneration for King Arthur and his personification by Prince Albert came at just the right moment. The monarchy was in crisis. Queen Victoria, after the death of Albert, withdrew into a surly retirement. English republicanism grew in strength, and Tennyson wrote against it.
The last tournament was written soon after the Paris Commune of 1871, which Tennyson denounced as the red fool fury of the Seine. Its villain is a red knight who threatens Arthur.
Tell them the king and all his liars that I have founded my round table in the north. And whatsoever his own knights have sworn, my knights have sworn the counter to it. And say, his hour is come. The heathen are upon him. His long lance broken, and his Excalibur a straw.
Arthur lets the drunkard kill himself, overbalancing head heavy into the mud.
Then the knights who watched him roared and shouted and leapt down upon the fawn. There trampled out his face from being known, and sunk his head in mire and slimed themselves.
Arthur's Britain, in the Tennyson who enshrined it in the minds of millions with his memorable poetry, played an appreciable part in reviving the glamour of the monarchy, long in default. It fostered that peculiar British mentality which sees medieval ritual and feudal monarchy coexisting with democracy, an attitude of mind coming under threat only in our own day. Perhaps the most influential Arthurian epic of the 20th century was T.H. White's The Once and Future King, which he began in 1939. White was a pacifist, and in the last book of the cycle, he has Arthur in a tent talking to a page boy on the eve of his last battle.
Page?
My lord?
Suppose I were to ask you not to fight, as a special favor to the king. Would you do that?
I should do what I was told.
Listen then. Sit for a minute. I will tell you a story. When you are old, you will be able to tell what I have told you tonight. And I want you to do that. Do you understand this want?
Yes, sir. I think so.
White stands the legends on their heads, juggling with timescales. The page boy is Tom of Newbold Revel. The future Sir Thomas Malory. Arthur, the Celtic warlord, was being used by T.H. White as a vehicle for his pacifism. Like many of his generation, he was influenced by the horrors of the First and Second World Wars and believed that another world war would bring total disaster.
What happened to the king in the end?
For some reason, things went wrong. The table split into factions. A bitter war began. And all were killed.
No, not all. The king won. We shall win.
Everybody was killed, except a certain page. I know what I'm talking about.
My lord?
This page was called Tom of Newbold Revel. And the king sent him off before the battle, upon pain of dire disgrace. You see, the king wanted there to be somebody left who would remember their famous idea. Try to remember that you are a kind of vessel to carry on this idea. When things go wrong, and that the whole hope depends upon you being alive. My idea of these nuts was a sort of candle. I've carried it for many years, with a hand to shield it from the wind. I'm giving you the candle now. You won't let it out.
It will burn.
Ladies and gentlemen of this convention.
The search for Arthur, the pining for the glorious age of Camelot, is in part an expression of our need for a flawless hero. In the 60s, John Kennedy became for many that hero, and his White House the new Camelot. The truth about his short life is almost irrelevant. He represented, and to some extent still represents, a yearning for a golden age which never existed, when noblemen lived and died by the highest of ideals. The mystery surrounding his death, like that of Arthur's, only confirms his mythic status.
It will burn.
The candle still burns. There's still a yearning for a golden age where men fought for truth and King Arthur was a flawless hero. In our age, it's packaged and commercialized. Welcome to today's Camelot.
And the Black Knight Mordred by! Ah!
Ah! But perhaps we no longer really believe in flawless heroes or that good always triumphs over evil. I had gone to the Camelot theme park near Preston, inclined to tut-tut about it all, to be the professional historian, disapproving of the exploitation of the Arthur myth. In the end, I rather enjoyed myself. It reflects the spirit of the age, a tongue-in-cheek attitude, exemplified by Monty Python and the Holy Grail. King Arthur had become a joke.
Be quiet! But by a two-thirds majority, in the case of... Be quiet! I order you to be quiet!
Order? Who does he think he is?
I'm your king.
Well, I didn't vote for you.
You don't vote for kings.
Well, how'd you become king, then?
The Lady of the Lake, her arm clad in the purest shimmering samite, held aloft Excalibur from the bosom of the water, signifying by divine providence that I, Arthur, was to carry Excalibur. That is why I'm your king.
Listen, strange women lying in ponds distributing swords is no basis for a system of government. Supreme executive power derives from a mandate from the masses, not from some farcical aquatic ceremony.
Be quiet!
Oh, but you can't expect to wield supreme executive power just because some watery tart threw a sword at you.
Shut up!
Oh, but if I went round saying I was an emperor just because some moistened bint had lobbed a scimitar at me, they'd put me away.
Shut up, will you? Shut up!
Ah, now we see the violence inherent in the system.
Shut up!
Oh, come and see the violence inherent in the system! Help, help, I'm being repressed!
The pagans are back. The New Age travelers are amongst the few for whom King Arthur and what they see as his Stonehenge connection is not a joke. Indeed, they have their own King Arthur, who every solstice and equinox arrives to take part in a dawn ceremony at Stonehenge.
King Arthur Pendragon.
Some of you may or may not be aware of the fact that I was imprisoned at the solstices, basically in Salisbury police cells, but they've now paid out for wrongful arrest and unlawful imprisonment, so from my point of view and from your point of view, if King Arthur can do it, I'm sure everybody else can, so we should all get here in summer, yeah?
Right.
Security guards are on hand to make sure that King Arthur and his followers cannot stand among the stones at sunrise.
Conjure thee, O circle of power.
For the faithful few, Arthur and Stonehenge symbolise Britain's pagan roots and a rejection of the mechanised, militarised society in which they live. But the New Age travellers are no longer the only people to take Arthur seriously. Hollywood came to North Wales to demonstrate that Arthur was back in fashion yet again. In their version, Richard Gere is Lancelot, Julia Ormond Guinevere, and Sean Connery Arthur himself. It may tell us something new about King Arthur. It's more likely to tell us about the preoccupations of the 1990s. The story is always shaped by the individuals who imagine it and the societies within which those people live.
Oh, well.
Fiction can provide only suspect evidence of real history. It must, of its very nature, make manifest the fantasies of the culture which spawns it. There is now a wealth of Arthurian material, scholarly and not so scholarly. But the Arthur I'm still haunted by is that of the deplorable but also memorable Tennyson. Tennyson rewrites the Excalibur story, changes Girfle to Sir Bedivere, and after Excalibur disappears into the lake, he has Arthur carried over to Avalon.
Long stood Sir Bedivere, revolving many memories, till the hull looked one black dot against the verge of dawn, and on the mere, the wailing died away. Ah, my Lord Arthur, whither shall I go? Where shall I hide my forehead and my eyes? For now I see the true old times are dead, when every morning brought a noble chance, and every chance brought out a noble knight. But now the whole round table is dissolved, which was an image of the mighty world.
There he goes, with over 1,000 years behind him. 1,000 years of a few facts and a myriad legends, with alpine ranges of interpretation erected upon them. Surely that's enough. But no, the process goes on and will never stop. So I prefer to say farewell to Arthur now, while he's still recognizable. As Bedivere said farewell on that desolate shore, mourning the true old times that are dead. I remember my own youth in the communist movement and the war, when everything seemed possible, a time of hope betrayed, as perhaps all such times are. So farewell, Arthur, in the words of Bedivere, who was, of course, the old Welsh hero, Bedwyr.
And I, the last, go forth companionless, and the days darken round me, and the years. Among new men, strange faces, other minds.
And the origins of the Arthurian myth are explored in a BBC book.